Ready? Good morning. Thanks, everyone, for being here. I'm Jay Melder. I'm the city manager of the city of Savannah. We're here to talk about St. Patrick's Day preparation. This is our second of three press conferences to talk about preparedness and helping the public understand what they need to do to have a safe and enjoyable St. Patrick's Day. Today, we're going to talk about traffic and transportation. So I want to start really with our timeline for St. Patrick's Day and Parade Day, which is this Friday, the 17th. The day starts at 6 a.m. That's when the public will be able to enter the squares along the parade route and set out their chairs and get their spaces ready for viewing the parade. The squares will be closed before 6 a.m. That day, and you will not be able to enter the squares until 6 a.m. At 6 a.m. also, vehicles will need to be removed from the parade routes. If you do not remove your vehicle from the parade route, we will remove it for you at a charge, but we would like not to do that. Street closures will also begin at 6 a.m. Want to remind folks that River Street will close daily at 10 a.m. We close River Street at 10 a.m. every day to give time enough for deliveries for our businesses along River Street. The parade starts at 10:15 a.m. The parade ends roughly at 3 p.m. and roads will begin to reopen when the parades end. And a reminder that the bars close at 2:55 a.m. That night. A few reminders for our parade goers as it relates to our public right-of-way and transportation and transit. You are not allowed to place chairs on the parade route until 6 p.m. the day before the parade. That's tomorrow. We would prefer you not lay out those chairs until the following morning. But anything before 6 p.m. Tomorrow evening will be removed from the right-of-way. Do not chain your chairs to any infrastructure. Please be aware of where you're placing chairs and keep our ADA and accessibility infrastructure open for those who need to use accessible right-of-ways. Please be mindful of that. And again, nothing along the parade route before 6 p.m. tomorrow. It will be removed, and nothing in the squares before 6 a.m. on Friday morning. A reminder that there will be no out-of-town motorcades allowed in the festival zone, and no on-street alcohol vendors or any entertainment on public right-of-ways within the festival zone as well. You can look at what the festival zone is. We're also expanding the to-go cup zone to meet the festival zone for Friday, March 17th only. So only on March 17th will the to-go cup zone be expanded, and those boundaries are roughly the bridge to the northwest, down MLK to Victory Drive, to the south, the Truman Parkway to the east, and the river to the north. Now I'd like to ask Stephen Henry, our Transportation Services Director, to come up and discuss some transportation safety tips. Before I do, I also want to acknowledge our Director of Mobility Services, Sean Brandon, is with us, and he'll be giving a presentation. The CEO of Chatham Area Transit, Faye DeMossimo, is here to talk about transit availability. We have Police Chief Lenny Gunther, Fire Chief Elsie Kitchen and their staff, and we are joined as well by Alderwoman Keisha Gibson Carter. So before Stephen Henry comes up, I just want to state some things that we want our festival goers to be mindful of and to remember, and we'll be reiterating this throughout our presentation today. One is to have a plan, two is to come early, and three is to be patient and stay calm. Traffic will be heavy, especially in the morning, and it will get heavier as the morning progresses up until the parade starts. We want you to take public transit. We want you to bike, or we want you to walk. If you do drive, we want you to come in early and park in a garage. If you do drive and do park on the street, we need you to be mindful of signage, because your car will be towed, and we don't want you blocking any drive, handicap spots or driveways or other things. So be mindful of that. But we're going to tell you all the reasons why you should take public transit, take a bike, take a walk, and if you do drive, come early and park in a garage. So with that, I'll turn it over to Director Henry. Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning. So we're fully expecting Friday and Saturday to have moments of heavy congestion and at times gridlock. Going to reiterate the notion to come early. Very important to have a plan. If you're driving, expect delays. Be patient. If you're walking, be alert. Use sidewalks. Use crosswalks. And you know, be aware, make sure drivers see you when attempting to cross roadways. Transportation staff will be working with Savannah PD, and will be monitoring traffic throughout Friday and Saturday, and adjust traffic signal timing, you know, look at opening or closing roads to help manage traffic in the downtown area for Friday and Saturday. Ms. Fay.
Faye DeMassimo with Chatham Area Transit. Fixed route and paratransit service will be zero fare in partnership with the City of Savannah from 4:30 a.m. to 10 p.m. on Friday and Saturday. No coolers or large objects are allowed. For the Savannah Vales Ferry, it will operate from 7 a.m. to 10 p.m. No service to the City Hall Landing, only to the Savannah Convention Center and the Waving Girl Landing. And the DOT shuttles will not operate on March 17th, but will resume their normal routes on March 18th. One of the things that we want to stress and emphasize is that we want everyone, as you've heard from others, arrive early, plan your enjoyable visit during this time, but please be sure and be mindful of having a bit of patience, because there are going to be delays with the traffic that will also impact our bus service. We're mindful of not only the experience of our residents and visitors that will be enjoying the festivities, but of our regular passengers who will still be trying to get to their grocery shopping trip, their medical, or whatever other event that they are trying to get to. So we're going to be working diligently to make sure that we meet the needs of all during this wonderful time. Thank you.
Hey, good morning. I'd like to just address a few things, specifically about parking and a couple of other items. First, if you are coming on Friday, our preference is that you go to a garage. Now, we have pre-sold roughly 900 spaces in garages, but there are still plenty of spaces left. I would encourage people to come down with a plan. How are you going to, which garage are you going to use? Where are you going to, how are you going to get into downtown? If you are going to use on-street spaces, there will be a limited amount of on-street spaces available on Friday. They will go very quickly early in the morning. I strongly encourage everyone to please note signage and be aware that just because you're not on the parade route does not mean that you're not in an area where towing might happen. There are areas like the staging area where towing can still happen. So please be mindful of signage. Within garages, there will be a flat rate for $25. That is for City of Savannah, city-owned garages. There are private, please note, there are private garages downtown. They will be charging different rates. You will know a city-owned garage because it will specifically say City of Savannah. Once again, encouraging people, please consider public transit. And just to put that in perspective, we have an inventory of about 4,000 off-street spaces. There's another 2,000 to 3,000 on-street spaces. We will have many more cars than that attempting to utilize all of those spaces, minus whatever gets taken away by the parade and by the staging area. So please think about public transit, think about walking, think about biking. If you are going to bike, please bike south of Broughton Street. Please put your bike, park it south of Broughton Street. North of Broughton is the concentration of the parade. You will find it very difficult to park a bike there or put it on a bike rack. So please, south of Broughton Street if you're going to bike. I would also note meters are free on Friday, all day Friday. Meters will be enforced on Saturday. So please note that if you're going to make an entire weekend of it. Also, even though we're not enforcing meters on Friday, we will be enforcing virtually everything else. So parking on sidewalks, in bike lanes, blocking driveways, at fire hydrants, all of that will result in a citation. There will be a full force of our people out to enforce those rules. Finally, we will be trying and enacting a rideshare plan this year. Geofences for rideshare will go up starting at Friday, 10 p.m. If you are within the control zone and are calling for rideshare, you may find that you are told to go to one of three specific pickup and drop-off locations, those being Indian Street, Johnson Square, or Telfair Square. The geofences will be up until 5 a.m. the next day, and then will go active again Saturday at 10 p.m. until 5 a.m. the next morning.
Thank you, Sean. So before we open it up for questions for staff, just to remember, have a plan for Friday. Take public transit, bike or walk. If you do bike, park your bike south of Broughton Street. If you do drive, park in a garage. If you do park on the street, mind the signage and be aware of pedestrians. Again, have a plan, come early, be patient, stay calm, get your book on tape, get a good podcast. Traffic's gonna be heavy in the morning if you're gonna be in your car. And we want you to stay calm, be patient, and be prepared for heavy traffic and a long time to find a spot to park and a long time to get to where your destination is. So with that, we can open up questions. Well, as Director Brandon said, we do have a new rideshare program and policy in place that we're working with Lyft and Uber to geofence those pickup and drop-off zones downtown. We've provided maps to the public on that. So if you are using Uber and Lyft, you will be directed to one of three spots downtown where Uber and Lyft will be picking up their fares. And we'll also be dropping off at those same locations. We made big changes to the festival ordinance last year. Those changes still exist. So the festival ordinance zone has expanded to the boundaries that I discussed earlier, roughly the Savannah River to the north, the bridge to the northwest, MLK Drive to the west, Victory Drive to the south, and Truman Parkway to the east. That festival zone also defines the to-go cup zone, which will be in place for Friday and Friday only. And the to-go cup zone will expand to meet those boundaries. And then, of course, and we'll talk about this more tomorrow when we have our public safety briefing, is the control area, which is roughly everything north of Broughton Street downtown. And that's where we have further restrictions on types of activities and types of things that you can bring into the control area to make sure that we have a better handle of public safety in our most densely populated part of downtown for the area. The thing that's going to be different about this year from last year is we're expecting much bigger crowds. It's a Friday parade, and people have made the decision to take off Friday and to visit Savannah. There's more than 18,000 hotel rooms in the Savannah area. They're almost all full, and we expect them to be full and for the folks who are in those hotel rooms to be coming downtown for the St. Patrick's Day festivities. Certainly many locals will be here as well. So expect big crowds, expect long delays if you're driving in town, which is, again, why we're reinforcing that CAT is a really great option to get downtown. That biking and walking is another great option. But if you do drive, come early, park in a garage, mind the signage, and be patient and stay calm.
Jay, one thing related to that that we would mention related to your question is we also added extra buses this year differently to several of the highest demand routes to make sure that this increased demand and to make sure that this choice to take CAT, that we can help to try to meet that demand.
Is Chief out there offering questions?
Certainly he is.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
What's up, team?
So I'm wondering about City Market. Of course, that is going to be the place people will be, especially at night. I'm wondering if there are going to be any extra police out, security, safety measures, things like that in that area?
For sure. Like the city manager already discussed, we know that certain areas are going to be extremely dense with our visitors and our community, and City Market being one of them. We've increased our staffing in specific areas, not only City Market, but across our city, because what we want to do is ensure that everyone has a safe and good time. We're focusing on a couple of things. One, being visible. Number two, being accessible. Number three, being proactive. And number four, and most importantly, making sure everyone has a safe and good time.
And in those locations, are there certain, because City Market, a lot of people think City Market is that entire square, but it's
not.
Right, but in that entire square, Ellis Square and City Market, where will police be staged exactly?
So we have certain zones then that we divide our entertainment district into, including City Market and the surrounding areas. So that zone that you're talking about will have a enhanced presence to make sure everyone has a good time.
Have you all been in contact with the owners at all? I know they have been putting, you know, fencing up after midnight for the past few months. Will that continue, extra lighting? I know there have been some safety measures already taken in City Market over the past few months. Will that continue? Will there be any extra?
We're going to keep our safety measures in place. We have made ad contact with the business owners in the area. Of course, lighting will be there. We're going to ensure that not only lighting, but again, our presence will be noted and visible.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you, Chief. Mm-hmm. And I'll say that tune in for tomorrow's briefing, where we'll be focused solely on public safety as well. So, thank you. Any other questions?
Yeah, so this might be for you, Mr. Miller, but do you have a specific crowd size number or any estimate that you all have?
We don't. We're expecting large crowds. I think, again, I'm fairly new, but we've seen crowds higher than 100,000 before, easy, and that's what we're expecting this year for a Friday parade. So we're expecting for the heaviest crowds that we've ever seen. So 311 is always a great option for city services that are non-emergencies. And Chief, you want to talk about the non-emergency number? Or Sergeant Pagliaro?
As far as PD goes, public safety issues, fire as well. If you call the non-emergency number, you can relay it through dispatch. They'll get it out to us as well. If you're in the downtown area, grab an officer, grab a firefighter, let them know. We all have radio communications back to the command post and can handle it that way as well. So 311 is for the majority of your issues, especially traffic concerns, anything, leaks, signs down, that kind of stuff. Let us know through 311. They'll also get in touch with that at the command post.
And it will not be hard to find a law enforcement officer or a firefighter the day of St. Patrick's Day. If just look to your left, look to your right. They're probably standing right behind you. They will be there to help.
Do you have any other questions?
We're good to go. All right. Have a plan. Come early. Be patient and stay calm. Thank you. Have fun. Great.